Welcome to Jubilee. Let's stand and gather. We're going to take some time to sing songs, to celebrate who God is, what he's done for us. He's faithful, and he's worthy of our praise. So we're going to glorify him this morning by singing him praise.
Wesley McCutcheon is my wife, Sam. We're going to be your service hosts this morning to welcome you in this morning. And if you're new here, I just want to say we're so glad you're here. And if you're a father in the room, we want to say happy Father's Day to you. We're so happy to have you here. Whether you're a biological father, a stepfather, adoptive or a foster father, or a spiritual father, your impact on our life has been huge. And we're so grateful to call you family. We're so grateful for what you've done in our lives. And we just hope you get celebrated today, as you guys definitely deserve. And we're going to have a great service today. And if this is your first time, we are so glad you're here, and we would love to get to meet you personally. Sam and I would, as well as our church. And there's actually people out in the lobby that would love to meet you as well at our Connect point that have a gift for you. And so please go get that after the service and say hi. And as we're just continuing in the service, also, if you sign up for Growth Track, that is happening right now up in our Growth Track room, and we would love for you to go. You can leave right now to go do that. And if you're curious about kind of who we are as a church, or if you want to maybe seek a little bit more what that could be, that could be a great step for you. So you can go do that right now. But as we continue in our service, we're going to be singing to Jesus. We're going to hear from the word, and then we're going to have a chance to respond in prayer and communion at the end.
Yeah, as we continue to sing on this Father's Day morning, we just want to remember the truth that we can relate to God as our Father, a Father who loves us, who has compassion for us. Psalms 103:13 says, "As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him." If you're new here, we hope that you experience a new and like fresh way of viewing God. God as our Father who loves us and has compassion for us. And that's why we sing. So let's sing together. This week, I really felt like God was just reminding me that He's the same God over the mountains as He is over the valleys.
And I don't feel the same when I'm in a mountain versus a valley. And my circumstances definitely don't feel the same. But I felt like he's reminding me, hey, in your victories, in your answered prayers, in your successes, I'm the exact same God as when you're in the valley and those things seem to go unanswered and you feel dry. And so I just felt like I was led to the scripture in Ezekiel 37 about the valley of dry bones. And just wanted to read it to you this morning. And if you're in a valley of just dryness, of unanswered, seemingly like God's not for you, I just want to say his unconditional love and his sovereign authority is still available to you in that. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of the valley. It was full of bones. And he led me around among them. And behold, there were very many on the surface of the valley. And behold, they were very dry. And he said to me, son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, you know. Then he said to me, prophesy over these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter you and you shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you and will cause flesh to come upon you and come over you with skin and put breath in you and you shall live and you shall know that I am the Lord God. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a sound and behold, a rattling. And the bones came together, bone to its bone. And I looked and behold, there was sinews upon them and flesh had come upon them and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain that they may live. And so I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, an exceedingly great army. And I just feel like, wow, I'm just this powerful. Like, that's the same God who loves you. That's the same God who has authority in your life. And so it may or may not change, but he is the same. And I think he wants to remind you of that this morning.
Sometimes our identity can be in ourselves and that falls short. But it goes on later to say that just that, that now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, who also will do it.
Yeah. When we gather together, we fully expect God to be among us. And one of the ways that he does that is he impresses things upon people's hearts that are encouraging for us. And that's what we just had. And so I just want to, you know, if either of those words or both of those words really spoke to you, I just want to encourage you to just really engage with God and hear what he's saying. He is the God of the valleys. If you're in a spot where you feel like, you know, where is God? I feel abandoned. Then these words are really speaking for you. God is faithful. And it may seem like that. It may seem like the darkness of you know, those days when after the crucifixion, Jesus was in the tomb. But there's something coming. The life of God is coming. That, you know, Jen mentioned on those dry bones. So let's just continue to worship the Lord as we just process that. Our own works, but we stand on the finished work of Jesus Christ, whose blood has redeemed us to a new life. We are new creation, Scripture says. Thank you, God, this morning. We just, Lord, we just love it. Sometimes it can, to think about a death, what good can come out of death? But God, you redeemed, God. And that's how we are now saved. We just thank you this morning, God. We celebrate you, God. Amen. Good morning. My name is Mike. I'm one of the elders here. Welcome to the 10:30 service. If I've not met you, hopefully I'll get a chance to do that sometime soon. Why don't you take a moment and say hello, greet somebody next to you, and then we'll continue with our service, a couple announcements, and then Brian is going to come share.
God is so good, and Sam and I are youth leaders here, so watching that video is like, it just hits our heart pretty deeply to see how youth are being, just like they're hearing from God personally, and they're getting to experience Him, and I'm just so thankful that we are part of a church that values the next generation. I'm thankful that you guys are praying for them, and we're seeing the fruit of that at conferences like this, weeks away like this, where we get together with our family of churches to really seek after Jesus. And it has made a big impact as youth have come to, they come to play games, they come to experience Jesus in it, and they get to really be their real selves and have real conversations with leaders and friends that they're making, lifetime friends. And we've seen the fruit of what, obviously, in that video, you see it. There was tons of baptisms. There's tons of experiences where teens are hearing from God personally. Yeah. It's like, oh, I love you. you. And it's amazing to see how they've received that and then chosen to follow Jesus with their life, which is amazing. And so, this is coming up, and it's very soon. So we would love, if you are a teen in the room, to register today for this. We'd love to have you there. Or if you're a parent, please register your youth for this, which you can do so by going onto our website.
Yeah, parents, a great opportunity to help support the youth and getting them to New Day is coming up on Friday, June 28th. We're having our parents' night out. Well, Ooh. We will be watching your kids as you enjoy some time alone. Hopefully enjoy some time alone. That's happening from 6:30 to 8:30 on, June 28th on Friday night. All the donations that are given will go towards getting youth and their leaders to camp to have these experiences with the Lord.
Yes, and would you please join us in welcoming up our lead pastor, Brian, to bring us the word.
How are we doing? Hey, I want to introduce you to a group of people we may want to help. This group of people in all 50 states are a half a letter grade behind. In 10 states, they are a full letter grade behind. They are twice as likely to be suspended from school. They are less likely to own a home. They are 50% less likely to graduate college, more likely to commit suicide, more likely to be imprisoned, and it is the single largest demographic factor in predicting early death. Do you think we should help this group? What if I told you this group were men? I don't know if you know this or not, but men in the West are in crisis. Probably don't hear about it very often, but male unemployment is the highest since the Great Depression. They are getting less degrees. They are marrying less. A guy by the name of Dr. Anthony Bradley in his research points out that 58% of males between the age of 15 to 24 have 58% have never approached a woman. This is leading to, and by 2030, they predict because of this, 50% of all females between the age of 15 and 44 will be single. Men are not attaching to work. They're not attaching to women. They're not attaching to school. Men are not attaching to fathers. They are attaching to pornography. In fact, they don't even do studies on the effects of pornography on 20-year-olds because they cannot find a control group large enough to do an effective study. Men are rapidly abandoning responsibility. There are 7 million able-bodied men who are choosing not to work. But worse than abandoning work, they are abandoning children. 50%, more than 50% of adolescents for the first time in our country don't live with their father, and 1 in 4 will grow up with a father of any kind. And children of fatherless homes, 90% of all homeless and runaway children come from fatherless homes. 91% of inmates, 81% of rapists come from fatherless homes. 60% of youth suicides come from fatherless homes. 4 times greater risk of poverty. Daughters are 7 times more likely to become pregnant as a teen, more likely to be abused, more likely to drop out of school, and is the number one predictor of future fatherlessness. So if you're like one of those people, like, man, what's wrong with our world? Like, why are prisons growing? Why are there more depression, suicide, homelessness? Why are all these things going in the wrong direction? There's a lot of talk about the ills of poverty and race, and I think as Christians, we should lean heavily into these discussions. But what the stats tell us, and it's not really even close, is that fatherlessness is a better indicator of incarceration, suicide, and homelessness than race or even poverty. President Obama, in addressing the nation a few years back, said that children without present fathers are 500% more likely to live in poverty and commit a crime, 900% more likely to drop out of schools, and 2,000% more likely to end up in prison. By ignoring men and not valuing their potential, we are producing the most dangerous people in society. It's putting our economy at risk. It's putting our daughters at risk. It's putting future generations at risk. And our prayer at Jubilee Church is not just for a better church or more effective ministry, but it's for the renewal of hearts, of cities, of nations. And when God answers those prayers for revival, it looks something like this as we read in Malachi 4. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes, and he will turn the hearts of fathers toward their children and the hearts of children toward their fathers. By God's grace, when a mother comes to faith, 17% of the family come to faith. When a child comes to faith, like we saw in those videos, 22% chance that the rest of the family comes to faith. When the father comes to faith, 94% chance that the rest of the family comes to faith. Whether you like it or not, men, and in particular fathers, have a disproportionate influence for both good and evil. So we are going to talk about men this morning. And if you're like women, if you're like, oh my gosh, I came on Man Sunday. Breathe, all right? Just breathe a little bit. Number one, it's Father's Day, and you should have known better. You know, for Mother's Day, we give them flowers and say all kinds of amazing things. On Father's Day, and I quote, is that today? Yes, Rachel, that is today. No, she's amazing. No. She's amazing at this. She's probably the most encouraging person I know. I'm sorry, okay? That was, the tongue got loose. Was that the intellectual Hindu that said, men who say they're sorry when they're wrong are honest. Men who say they're sorry when they think they're wrong are wise. Men who say they're sorry when they know they're right are husbands. And so we, you're home free unless they ask, what are you sorry for? And then it's like, oh man, I was so close. Number one, it's Father's Day, and you should have known better. Number two, you have a massive role to play. You have a massive role. For better or for worse, we really care what you think. I know our fragile little egos will never, ever, ever let you know that. But you can be a force to encourage us into godliness or participate in our demise. Number three, if you follow the data, if you do your research, where men step into their purpose, everything flourishes. When they refuse, everything burns. So I've got a few goals this morning. Number one, I want to get out of here alive. All right, so just bear with me. Number two, I want to help men be all that God has called them to be as defined by him and not culture. Number two, I want to enroll everyone in Jubilee Church to get behind this endeavor and participate in repairing what is a crisis in our culture and is wreaking havoc. And finally, and this is personal, I want the daughters in the house to have high standards of how other men treat you. I want you to have a biblical filter for which you can say, that's not okay. You can't talk to me that way. You can't treat me that way. And you will have the authority of the Bible to stand on and not some lyric from a Taylor Swift song. But it's not lost on me, hence my first goal, that masculinity as a whole is being viewed through a lens which is problematic. I know what I'm doing. You're like, does this guy know what he's doing? Yeah, I know what I'm doing, but I know that's where culture is. In fact, in 2018, the APA put forth their first ever guideline for counseling young men. It denounced traditional masculinity ideology as psychologically harmful. In November of the same year, Susanna Walters, a professor of gender studies from Northeastern University, wrote an article in the Washington Post titled, "Why Can't We Hate Men?" Now, you can read the whole thing, but she says, it's only logical, I quote, to hate men. Growing movements to challenge masculinity, she says, are both gratifying and necessary. And she ends the article by saying, so men, if you would like us not to hate you, don't run for office, don't be in charge of anything, we got this. But it's not just some women saying this, men are saying this too. In his book, Refusing to Be a Man, John Stoltenberg says, talking about healthy masculinity is like talking about healthy cancer. James Cameron, more recently, just a couple months ago, who did Avatar, of course, he said testosterone is a toxin that you have to slowly work out of your system. And this ideology is creeping into how children are being raised. There was a publication in Australia, wrote an article about putting an end to the menace of masculinity so that your six-year-old boy doesn't grow up to be a monster. And this is having devastating consequences. Some people are talking about it. In fact, in the Wall Street Journal recently, Erica Komisar said, in my practice as a psychotherapist, I've seen an increase of depression in young men who feel emasculated in a society that is hostile to masculinity. So what is our approach? What is the Christian response to what it means to be a man and how we proceed from here? Well, in 1 Corinthians 16, Paul writes this. He says, be watchful. Stand firm in the faith, act like men, the real translation is play the man. It's how you be a man. Let all that you do be done in love. So what does it mean to be a man? Got to address a couple false narratives. Got to do a little deconstruction before we can construct. False narrative number one, many people have a comic view of idea of what it means to be a man. So a man is someone who drives a pickup truck. You know, they eat red meat. You know, they could skin a deer with their fingernails. Their favorite color is camo. And people look at a guy like that, like, that's a man. But none of those things make you a man. Make you awesome, but they don't make you a man. It's a false narrative that defines masculinity by the hobbies that you have or by your emotions, or should I say lack thereof. So we tell boys, quit crying, suck it up, be a man, stop acting like your sister. Men don't feel, men do. Now, I'm not going to ask you to raise your home, but anybody grow up in a home like that? It's faux masculinity nonsense. It teaches a toxic form of masculinity is the ideal. Now, first of all, men don't cry doesn't line up with Jesus. Doesn't line up with King David, who wrote poetry and played the harp. And oh, by the way, ripped a bear in two with his bare hands. So if you're like, I'm a man, I don't have emotions. And like, well, you go one-on-one with him, you know, like, I know you do CrossFit and everything, but you're not going to win that one. Faux masculinity produces self-centered, violent men. I get what I want because I'm a man. That's what it says. I get what I want because I'm a man. But listen, you are a man. You are not an animal. Obvious point? Maybe. Genesis 1. And God made the beasts of the earth. Then, God said, after making the animals, I'm going to make something different. Let us make man in our image, after our likeness. A man is not an animal. An animal is ruled by their desires. They get hungry, they eat, they get tired, they sleep, they get angry, they fight, they get sexy, they sex. And some places, that is the definition of a man. The manliest dude is the one who can drink the most beer, eat the most food, win the most fights, bed the most women. If we define masculinity that way, it should be no surprise. Sexual assault's on the way up. Abuse of women's on the way up. Abandonment of children is on the way up. And we have told a generation of men they are nothing but purposeless animals. And then we act surprised when they act that way. But a man's not an animal. False narrative number two on the other side of the road. There is no difference. There's no difference between men and women. So let's level the playing field. Let's remove strength from men or just deny that exists, which is naive at best, but on the other end is pretty dangerous. In 2018, there was a mass shooting in a local bar in Thousand Oaks, California. The killer was 28-year-old Ian David Long, college dropout, former Marine, divorced, unemployed, living with his mother, went to this bar. It's college night, knew there'd be 200 or 300 college students there. He puts on black clothes, draws his hood over his head, tosses smoke grenades to create confusion, and then takes out his pistol with a laser guide and mows down 13 people, including one police officer. In that very crowd, there was another young man. He was 20-year-old Matt Winterstrom. He wore his hat backwards and a scruffy beard, looked like the typical college student, but what he did was not typical. As soon as the shots started firing in the bar, he led his friends to grab as many people as they could and push them under the pool table for cover, and then they piled their own bodies over top of them to protect them. Two young men, one used their masculine strength to kill, to take lives. One used his masculine strength to save lives. When you forfeit masculinity, you forfeit a great restraint on male vice and a great incentive for male valor. But I get that I'm walking on thin ice because everything in this culture is screaming at you that says this: distinction equals inequality. Distinction equals inequality. But if you and I are going to be serious people, serious about what's wrong with the world, and we're going to stand on what we would say is the authority of Scripture, we need to feel the Scriptures bearing the weight on this issue, listen to me, for the good of all people. So what are the commands given to express a godly form of masculinity? Number one, be watchful, which really means to be a serious person. Don't be silly. I mean, you can have fun, but don't be a boy is what it's saying. You know, there's a difference between a man and a boy who can shave. Boys are great, but they demand that everyone else take care of them, but men seek to take care of everyone else. Genesis 2 gives us the pattern. You get a job. You can write this down. Get a job, leave your parents' home, you get married, then you have sex and have kids. That's the pattern. Genesis 2:15, this is a command. The Lord took the man and put him in the garden to work it and keep it. He gave him a job. Verse 24, therefore a man shall leave his mother and father, leaves the house. Number two. Number three, they get married. Number three, they shall become one flesh. One flesh is Hebrew for bow chicka wow wow. And so we... You gotta get, the order is important. You get a job. You leave your parents' home. You get married. And then you create a family. Now, does that mean that you have to be married and have kids in order to be a man? No. But it does mean that you are the type of person who is willing to work for and sacrifice for the good of other people. It means that you're that type of person. So be watchful, be a serious person, don't be a boy. And then secondly, this is a big one, stand firm. Specifically stand firm on the finished work of Christ, the gospel. Men are prone to shame. I don't know if you know this or not. Men are prone to shame. If our fragile little egos would allow us to uncover the shame that we feel, that we're not good enough, that we can never cut it, that we can't get it right, it would blow your mind. We're not willing to tell that to each other. We're not going to say it to you. The lie of not measuring up is what the enemy uses to tear down biblical masculinity. Most men, virtually every guy I know, wants to show up for the people in their life, but they are deeply afraid they're not good enough. And it keeps us from trying because this is another flaw of us, but we don't play if we can't win. And a lot of us, not all of us, a lot of us have a memory tattooed on our brain of a teacher, of a coach, of a dad who said that we won't measure up. It happened 25 years ago. It happened one time, and it very real to some people in this room right now. Under the weight of shame, men go in two different directions. We either double down on a false view of masculinity, make Andrew Tate our hero, or number two, we downshift into insecurity and we lay down our desire to fight, protect, and be strong. Brothers, I want to call you to stand firm on the finished work of Christ on our behalf. It is the best chance, it's the only chance to genuine masculinity because it allows you to lean into your weaknesses rather than hide them. And maybe you've bought into a form of masculinity that, you know, masculine men don't struggle. They don't show weakness. But the reason why we hide from our weaknesses is not our strength. It's because we are afraid of being ashamed. The gospel, the finished work of Christ, gives us the strength and the tools to gladly admit our weaknesses. Some of our lives are filled with anger and rage because we're failing short of our quest for honor and respect at work, at home, when the gap that we feel can only be filled by the finished work of Jesus on our behalf. And so the more that we project our strength, the more weak and dangerous we become. The more you and I project our own strength, the more weak you and I become. If what you stand firm in is you, I'm a good father, I'm a good man, I'm a good businessman, I'm a good husband, I'm a good leader, I'm a good father. When failure happens, not if, when it happens, shame comes knocking on your door and you will either move toward withdrawal or aggression. You'll do one of those things. When a man experiences shame, he will either hide out or lash out. And who does he lash out with the most? Women and children. Some won't lash out, some will hide out, which isn't a whole lot better. Or if you're like me, you do both. Michael Hoff famously said, hard times produce strong men. Strong men produce good times. Good times produce soft men. Soft men produce hard times. I'll let you figure out where in the cycle we are. At Jubilee, we don't want to be men who lash out or hide out, but step out to be the men that God's called us to be. So we're going to stand firm on the finished work, not on our own good deeds and who we are, but this is what Christ, I mean, even in our shortcomings, we can reflect what it means to be a man. Work can't give you that. Spouses can't give you that. Children can't give you that. Only Christ can give you that. So when we fall short of the glory of God, when we fall short of the glory of God, we're going to confess that to God and to our brothers. We're going to out the devil as a liar, and we're going to step into our destiny, and we're going to be men who declare the goodness of God with holy hands raised, not because of our strength, but because of his. And this informs our next command, which is to be strong. Be strong in what? Keep trusting Jesus. Keep leaning into him. Don't let go of grace. Brothers, you and I are going to fall short, but 1 John 2 says that we have an advocate. We have one that we can call to, that when we sin, not if we sin, but when we sin, when we fall short, he builds us back up. Finally, his command in being a man is to let all that you do be done in love. The driving force behind being a man, the engine, the thing that makes the thing work is love. Not physical strength, it's love. The question that people are asking, they're more than asking, they're asserting. Is it wrong for men to have power? The obvious answer, I think, is, well, it depends how they use it. Jesus in John 13, this is what he did. No, Jesus, knowing that the Father had all things in his hands, in heaven and on earth. That's a lot of power. Everything. He had it all. What did he do? He rose from supper. He laid out his outer garments, and taking a towel, he tied it around his waist. Then he poured it into a basin, began to wash the disciples' feet, and wiped them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He said, I could call down a legion of angels and totally get what I want. But he rose, he took off his outer garment, and he served. When we talk about being masculine, when we talk about male leadership, that's what we're talking about. And this type of male leadership is having some surprising results, surprising to those who are critical of this, because after this is over and over being asserted, there's some social scientists that said, we want to go look at some data. And so they went digging. And Bradford Wilcox in the New York Times wrote this. New York Times did a huge research project. You probably never heard of it, but it's out there. They concluded this: the happiest of all wives in America are religious conservatives. 73% of wives who hold to conservative gender values and attend religious services regularly with their husbands have high-quality marriages. These men spend 3.5 hours more per week with their children than the average man, lower divorce, and have the lowest rate of domestic violence of any group in the USA. Academics, he says, need to cast aside their prejudices about religious conservatives and evangelicals in particular. Married Protestant men are consistently the most active and expressive fathers and the most emotionally engaged husbands. This isn't some pep talk in the Bible Belt pushing a narrative. This is well-documented empirical data from a social scientist writing for the New York Times. And everybody was shocked. I mean, the researchers are shocked by what they found. Because you have people like the co-founder of the Me Too movement who said that the theology of male leadership in the home feeds a rape culture that we see permeating American Christianity today. So they went back and looked and they dug a little deeper and they made a very helpful distinction. They compared the data between men who were serious about their faith versus men who were nominal. Nom, N-O-M, is Latin for name. In name only. So the survey said, so they compared people who were serious about their faith versus people who were check the box Christian, but they were Christian by name only, so they barely were engaged. Nominal men tested out very different and do match the toxic stereotypes that get complained. Nominal evangelical men less engaged with their children than their secular counterparts, less their wives report lower levels of happiness, highest rates of divorce, 20% higher than secular men, and have the highest rate of domestic abuse and violence than any group in the United States. Brad Wilcox concludes, the most violent husbands in America are nominal evangelical Protestants who attend church infrequently or not at all. So nominal men are those who hangs out on the fringe of the Christian world just long enough to hear language of things like headship and submission. But they don't go deep enough to understand the biblical meaning of those terms. So they have biblical vernacular with Andrew Tate Dictionary. Ladies, they are the most dangerous to you. Don't go find some stray online who puts Baptist on their dating profile. Close is not close enough. If they don't have a group of men around them that they are connected to and receiving from, they are very dangerous to you. And men, if you are on the fringe, man, there is so much at stake. You cannot afford to stay there. You cannot afford to stay there for you. You cannot afford to stay there for your spouse and for your kids and for the good of the society. We want to call you forward. There's no shame in that. We all fall short. We're not who we're supposed to be. Nobody can stand on their own 2 feet. We stand firm on the finished work of Christ. Not everybody around here, they may look like they have it together, but they don't have it together. So what do you want to do? Well, Paul says this. He says, have this mind amongst you. Men, have this mind amongst you. Have this mind amongst yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though in the very form of God did not account equality with God's thing to be grasped. Again, he's not holding on to his rights and responsibilities, but he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form. He humbled himself by being obedient to death, even death on a cross. We want to encourage the men in our life who are doing well to keep going, to be who God's called them to be, even when they fail. And we want to know how to reach out to those men who aren't. You know, Adam, he gets his command. And then in chapter 3, as we all know, is he has the leadership test, and he hides out. He hid out. And what he should have done, instead of allowing the enemy to lead his family, and men, if you don't fight for your wife, you don't fight for your kids, you don't fight for their hearts, the enemy will gladly take that place. And what Adam should have done is he should have stood between his wife and the tree and looked Satan in the eye and said, "Over my dead body." And then did mortal combat, risking his life to crush his head. A few thousand years later, the Bible says there was another Adam who did stand between us and the tree. And he looked Satan in the eye and he said, "Over my dead body." And Romans 5 says that through one man's sin, we've all become broken and fallen. How much more through Jesus Christ shall we all receive grace and power? Men, there is grace for you. You don't have to live up to whatever ideal that you have. The truth is you can't. The good news, though, is there's one who did it for you. And when you walk with him and follow him and trust him, you're not going to be dangerous to anyone. I mean, women and children flocked around Jesus because of his desire not to be served, but to serve and to love and to be a blessing. And that's what we want to be. We want to call men to that. Men, would you stand with me? The band could come up. I just want to pray for the men in this room. And if you, I want to encourage you as well to agree with me. But it could be after I'm done praying that there'll be a prayer team over here that you may want to get specific prayer. Maybe as a man, you're dealing with shame. Maybe as a man, you're just like, "Man, I'm on the fringe and I need help." Or maybe you've been abused by a man, a father, a husband, a brother, someone you trust. You've been hurt and you need prayer. Or maybe you're just like, I want to be an encourager of other men. I want to be filled with grace and to forgive and to love and to encourage and to champion. You may want to get prayer for one of those things. But I'm just going to pray for us, and then we'll move on in our service. Father, we just thank you for your grace in our lives. God, we're the first Adam failed. Lord Jesus, you succeeded, the second Adam. And God, in your victory, Jesus, in your victory, we have victory. And we just want to, we want to repent from trusting in ourselves. We want to repent in lashing out and hiding out. We want to repent from standing on our work. We want to stand firm on your work. We want to be the men who gladly admit our weakness. Because when we are weak, you are strong through us. God, we just thank you that there's so much grace for us. Lord, your grace removes the shame. And God, I just pray that you would lift shame off the men in this room. I pray you would help them, Lord Jesus, to be vulnerable. I pray, Lord, they'd be surrounded by godly men who challenge and encourage, pray for, and are those instruments of grace. God, we understand the dangers, the threat that men can be. God, we want to reject that view of faux masculinity. But God, we don't want to deny what your word says, what you've called us to. So God, would you help us be? Would you help us to walk in our calling as men? In Jesus' name, amen. We all can stand.
Going to continue in our service by receiving communion. So if you're a follower of Jesus, you can follow the graphic behind me to grab your elements and just pay attention to the ushers. They will dismiss you row by row.
My sin that held him there.
His dying breath has brought me life, and I know that it is finished. Oh, it's finished. I will, and I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my
When Jesus spent the last night with His disciples, the Last Supper, He was celebrating the feast of the Passover, which was a celebration of when God delivered the Israelites from bondage in Egypt. And Jesus redefined, in that Last Supper, He redefined the elements that are traditionally used in that meal. And He redefined them centered on Him. And it was a new covenant. It was different from just simply taking somebody and putting them into a good situation, which is what He did with the Israelites. And that didn't work. So when Jesus came, He knew what we needed deliverance from was sin and evil and death and our collusion with them. And so what we're doing when we take the bread and the cup is we're remembering that God has brought this deliverance, that the full force of God's wrath that was due us, Jesus took on the cross, and He brought freedom from those things. So now we walk in freedom from sin and death and evil, because God has transferred us from the line of Adam into the line of Christ. We were in Adam, now we are in Christ by faith. And so let's receive the bread and the drink and remember the fullness of what God has done for us through Jesus. Like to read a benediction and pray a prayer over us before we go. Our Father in heaven, You are a good and loving Father. All the strength and blessing from earthly fathers is simply a reflection of Your goodness and love. All the longing and heartache caused by broken and imperfect fathers will be satisfied in You. As Your sons and daughters, may we grow in our relationship with You. As Your family, may we build up and encourage fathers to grow in Your likeness. As a church community, may we together exemplify You by fathering the fatherless. We bow our hearts to You, Father God, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. And we pray that You give us strength and power through Your Spirit. And now, may God bless you and keep you. May He cause His face to shine on you and be gracious to you. And may God look with favor on you and give you peace. And everybody said, amen. Before we go, Today we're celebrating fathers, and we see in Scripture that God puts into the hearts of fathers the desire and the call to be sacrificial, to protect, to give their life for others. And we want to celebrate that today, so there's going to be root beer floats in celebration. So grab a root beer from the truck that's outside in front, and, or grab an ice cream and then a root beer on your way out. Happy Father's Day to fathers. It was great being with you today. If you need prayer, there's a prayer team to my left that would love to pray with you. See you next week.